church, wherever you are, we're going to just worship this song. We're going to sing of his goodness. You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness. You give hope and you restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, Lord. It's your breath.
Welcome to worship. My name is Stephen Usher. I'm the lead pastor of Sugarloaf, and I just wanted to take a few minutes in the middle of our worship service today to communicate with you about some of our plans as we've been working to think about reopening our campus. Let me say first off, though, how important it is that we've seen so many people worshiping with us online. So if you are one of our online worshipers, and maybe you're even states apart from us, welcome. We're so glad you're connecting in with us this summer. And if you are one of the folks that were local right here in the area, I want to share a little bit about our reopening task force, the work that we're doing to get ready to reopen our campus. Now here in Georgia, we've had some spikes of COVID, and we've had some cases in our county that have been very strong. We're kind of at a red level alert. Even with our governor's orders, we've continued to have to push off our date. We originally planned to reopen our campus on August the 9th, and I would love more than anything today to tell you a date that we think we're going to be able to reopen. But as our reopening task force has been studying the data, as we've been also receiving information from the United Methodist Church and some guidance from some other organizations as well, really what we're looking for right now is a metric. We're looking for 5 days where here in Gwinnett County, we would see the COVID rates decrease. And then we think we'll be able to posit a date very soon for being able to reopen. But during this time, let me just encourage you towards a couple of things. Number one, I think all of us are experiencing maybe some extended friends or family members that are having contacts with COVID right now. So we encourage you, stay safe, and we pray prayers of protection over your family. As a matter of fact, in a few minutes, I'm going to be praying a prayer of protection over you and your family. Just we encourage you during this time to stay safe while we're in this waiting mode. And by the way, spiritually, the Bible talks a lot about waiting. You know, guys, we can win in waiting sometimes. The Bible talks over and over again about waiting for the Lord. And so that's kind of this mode we're in right now. We're having to wait. And by the way, for some of us, and I can say that's true for me, waiting isn't a fun thing. We don't enjoy it. We don't look forward to it. But sometimes waiting is the best thing. You know, the psalmist said, we wait for the Lord. I wait and I trust in you. And so while we wait, let me just encourage you towards a couple of things. If you are in a small group or if you're not in a small group, community is important right now. And we're going to be opening up our campus for some small groups to meet on our campus to socially distance while they're meeting here. But we just think it's very important for small groups of all different kinds to be meeting. And we want to facilitate that. And if you're not in a small group, we'd love to be able to connect you into a small group. You can email the person in charge of small groups here at Sugarloaf, meredith@sugarloaf.org, and we'll make sure to get you into a small group. And the other thing that I want to mention to you today is just a word of thanksgiving. You know, we've been in the season of not being able to have campus worship, but we've had a lot of people connecting in with us online. And yet in this time, faithful, generous Sugarloafers have helped to support our ministry. Even during the months of June and July, which are normally a lot leaner types of months, we've had great and gracious support. So thank you, Sugarloaf, for your constant support of God's kingdom work through our church. Our ministries are still going on. They're just having to go on in an online and digital way. So if you will, as we continue to worship, and then we're going to sing a song in just a second about trusting in God, leaning into Him, I want to pray for you, and I want to pray for your family, and I'd love to pray with you for our church. Would you pray with me? God, we thank you for your constant presence in our lives. And even in seasons of waiting, your presence is always with us. I remember that Paul wrote, "What can separate us from the love of Christ? Nothing." He talked about heights and depths, and he talks about all kinds of things that try to separate us, but nothing can separate us from your love. So Lord, in this season of waiting, I pray a prayer of protection over every family. Lord, I pray that you would keep us safe, especially those who are most vulnerable right now in our society. We pray for our county and we pray for our state, Lord, for the numbers to drop and for us to be able to move into what I know many of us are looking forward to, a new normal, a way of getting back to life. And Lord, we pray for that moment. I pray over our reopening task force and our Sugarloaf Council that God, you would help us make the right decisions, that when we would reopen in a way that is celebratory and super safe. But God, it is a moment for our body to be back together. Thank you, Lord, for this day of worship. We give you our heart. We give you our trust. And Lord, in the next few minutes, we give unto your kingdom gain. So take these, our gifts, multiply them for your kingdom work, Jesus. We love you. We worship you. In the name of Christ we pray. Amen. Welcome to week 7 of Monumental Faith. All this summer we've been traveling through Washington, D.C. We've been studying how faith was the cornerstone of the American experiment. We've been seeing the founding fathers' faith literally carved in marble and granite, in wood and in parchment. I pray this series has been a blessing to you. As we are in week 7 here, I want to stop on two places today. We're going to stop at a church, which is the only church on our journey, and then we're going to travel to another location, and we're going to talk about leadership in America today. Like always, I invite you to go by our website, print out the notes and the outline ahead of today's message. Well, this church is a very important church. It sits just two blocks this side of the White House. And if we were to travel the other way, it's about 2 miles to Capitol Hill. Well, this church was founded in 1793 by Scottish stonemasons. It sits right here as it's been built many times, rebuilt. But in 1951, the edifice that you see behind me here today was constructed. There's a cornerstone that sits at this church that was placed there by Harry S. Truman, our president. That cornerstone is even a testament to his faith. And let me read to you what that cornerstone says. It says, "To the glory of God, this stone laid by President Harry S. Truman, 3rd of April, 1951. Well, that is a stone outside the church that is a cornerstone, but it's not the only thing that marks the historicity of this church. There's another plaque that talks about the 17 stained glass windows inside. Each stained glass window telling a story about God's providence over this nation and how He blessed this nation to become what it is today. By the way, I wish I could take you inside. There's actually a pew that was reserved for Abraham Lincoln. They have it on display inside because 17 U.S. presidents have worshiped in this church. Now, the reason I bring you here today is not for the pew and is not because Harry Truman dedicated the building. It's actually to tell you the story about a sermon that was preached inside of this church. The sermon was preached on Abraham Lincoln Day, a day in February, and one of our presidents, President Eisenhower, attended worship service that day. The pastor of the church, his name was Reverend George Dougherty, and that day he preached a message about the need for America to acknowledge God. And the thing that he suggested was that our pledge, even our Pledge of Allegiance, had no acknowledgement of God in it. He said, this ought not be. As a matter of fact, he said that there is an acknowledgement of God that America does regularly and that is a part, as he said, of this characteristic and the definitive factor of being an American, of American life. He suggested that we find some way to put God in the Pledge of Allegiance. Well, that day, like many other days, after he preached his message, he walked to the front doors. And as he stood at the front doors, he said goodbye to parishioners, and the president came by. President Eisenhower came by, and as they talked for a moment, the pastor asked him, "Well, Mr. President, what did you think of my sermon?" President Eisenhower said 3 simple words: "I entirely agree." Well, interestingly enough, the next day, on that Monday, Congress proposed a bill, and the bill was to add 2 words to the Pledge of Allegiance: under God. Those iconic words that had been used by George Washington so many times, Abraham Lincoln: one nation under God. Well, it took 4 months before the bill actually arrived to Dwight Eisenhower's desk at the White House, and then he signed it, and that's how our pledge was changed to acknowledge God's providence over America. Today we're going to talk about leadership. Every nation needs leadership. Every community needs leadership. Every family needs leadership. It needs godly leadership. And I think it's very interesting to think about the leadership of a pastor who reached the president, and how the president's power reached Congress, and how all of a sudden effective change swept over the nation, even in the way we use our words today about the pledge. Well, we're going to make another stop on our journey today. We're going to travel to the most powerful office in the world. Join me. Welcome to the quintessential symbol of the American presidency. This is the White House. And the White House has served as both the private home and the executive office, and for not only the president, but his senior staff, for every president except George Washington. You know, it's in this place that when you look at this home, you need to think of a few just incredible moments that happened in this building. Think of Thomas Jefferson unrolling maps, the maps of Lewis and Clark for their expedition. It was in this place, this very building, that Abraham Lincoln signed the Emancipation Proclamation. And it was also in this building that was JFK navigated the Cuba Missile Crisis, and Roosevelt held fireside chats while America moved through a depression. I wish we could get closer. We've been in D.C. during a very tumultuous time. We've had a lot of protests going on, some nonviolent, some turning into riots, and there's a lot of security in our area right now. But we wanted to come to the White House because this is a symbol of leadership for our country and for the world. Now in 1790, think about that year, 1790, Washington he decided that he wanted the home of the president to be here in the District of Columbia. And so in 1791, he was able to find this location, pick out the spot for where that home would be located. Washington laid the cornerstone for the White House in 1792. And he oversaw much of the construction of the White House, but he never got to live in it. It was John and Abigail Adams, our second president, who were the first to move into the White House and to live here as their personal residence. Now, across all the years, you must imagine, from the late 1700s to present day, there have been a lot of modifications to this building. Whether it be running water, electricity, telephone service, gas light, a lot has happened to upgrade this building into the building that it is today. Now, for our purposes, as we're thinking about Judeo-Christian values and the places where we see faith in America, I just want to remind you of the times that the White House is used to have Christian symbolism all around it. Now, right now, I'm standing in front of what's called the ellipse. It's kind of like the front lawn of the White House. It's large, but if you came here at Christmas time, you would not only see the national Christmas tree behind me here, you would see the ellipse adorned with Christmas trees from every state. They would be all around the ellipse, as well as the national Hanukkah memorial to celebrate the Jewish season. Well, also at Easter, ever since 1878, they've come on this front lawn and done the Easter egg roll. Inside the White House, there have been numerous prayer services. The national prayer breakfast is held right here at the White House. They've had hymn singings, and even one president, Rutherford B. Hayes and his wife, they renewed their Christian vows of their wedding, their marriage, right here in the White House. Now, a few years ago, I was able to visit at the White House, and we were able to actually visit one room in particular that was very special to me. It was the State Dining Room. The State Dining Room is a gorgeous place where the president hosts formal dinners. Now, I want to tell you a story real quickly about the State Dining Room. Franklin Delano Roosevelt was actually living in the White House, and he found a note from a former president. He found a note from the second president. I mentioned to you that John and Abigail Adams were the first folks to ever live in the White House. He found a note that John Adams had written to his wife, but it mentioned a prayer. This is what that note said. "I pray to heaven to bestow the best of blessings on this house and on all hereafter that inhabit it. May none but the honest and wise men ever rule under this roof." Well, when FDR found that note, it was so special to him that he decided that in the State Dining Room, he would have that prayer, that note that was written to Abigail Adams by John Adams, carved into the mantle of the fireplace. Every president since FDR would see that fireplace that is there. And that note, one more time, listen to those words. "I pray to heaven to bestow the best of blessings on this house and all that hereafter inhabit it. May none but the honest and wise men ever rule under this roof. You know, leadership is important. As we come to this place today, I'm reminded of what the Bible says about godly leadership, wise leadership to rule a nation. We, as Americans, we need godly and wise leadership. Let me share a couple of biblical scriptures that just remind us of this. Proverbs 11:14 says these words, "Without wise leadership, a nation falls. There is safety in having many advisors." Romans 13:4 says it this way, "For the one in authority is God's servant for your good." Well, today, Sugarloaf, I brought you to this place so that we could pray for the leadership of America. And oftentimes, when we pray at Sugarloaf, we reach out a hand. We lay a hand on whomever we're praying for as a symbol of us asking the Holy Spirit to be on them. Today, I want to ask you, wherever you are, in your living rooms and as you're with your family, wherever you are, I want to invite you to pray with me over the leadership of our country. The leadership, wise, godly leadership, it affects the rise and the fall of every nation. So as we pray today, I'm going to ask you literally to stretch your hand towards the White House. And we're going to pray for this president and this vice president and every vice president and president that would ever be in this White House and all of their administrations. And at the same time, right down the road here is the Capitol. I'm going to stretch my hand towards the U.S. Capitol, and we're going to pray for the House of Representatives, for the Senate, for those who would lead in that very special place as well. And would you join me that we would pray for wisdom, for godliness, for righteousness to be theirs? Would you pray with me? Stretch your hand towards the White House with me. Stretch your hand towards the Capitol. Let's pray together. God, we thank you for your presence in our lives. We thank you that, Lord, you can control and govern the affairs of a nation through its leadership. Today, as I stretch my hand towards the U.S. Capitol, I pray for the House of Representatives and for the Senate. I pray for all those who run our government. I pray for even the Supreme Court located right behind the Capitol, God. I pray for your wisdom and your righteousness to be over those who serve us, who serve the people in leadership. And God, we also stretch our hand towards the White House. We pray for our president and our vice president and their administration. We pray also for this home and for every future president and their administrations. God, we pray that your will would be done, that they would have spiritual ears to hear your voice. God, we pray that you would give godly counsel. The Bible talks about wisdom and advisors. God, you want to bless your wisdom over them. Give them your thoughts and your ways. So God, we pray for them. We lay our hands on them today, God. And we pray that the leadership of America would not only be wise, but it would be righteous and godly. Lord, thank you for this day that we get to just lay our hands on our leadership and pray for them. We pray, Lord Jesus, in unity, that you would raise up strong, godly leadership, that you would bless the leadership of our country. Thank you, Jesus. This is our prayer. In your most holy name we pray. Amen. I want to thank you for being with me on this journey. We're almost getting to the end, and we have a couple more stops along the way. Don't miss next weekend as we close out this series called Monumental Faith. If you will, share with me that benediction we always together pray at the end of our worship services. And now, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O God, my rock and my redeemer. God bless you, Sugarloaf. Have an awesome week.